What's up, Daniel Tiger's neighborhood?
Man, I'm living bologna sandwich. How are you?
Man, I'm doing all right, man. It's been a long week, but man, I enjoy taking time to just sit back and do this, man.
Absolutely. So do I. So what do you say? Let's build a bar.
Let's do it. Okay, so this is our fourth episode, and so it's your turn to add something to our bar. So what, in fact, did you bring to add to the bar tonight?
So tonight I brought Wild Turkey 101.
Nice.
It is one of my, it's one of my favorites for a lot of reasons. Couple of those we'll get into, complexity being probably the number one. I do enjoy the complexity that's behind
it. All right, well, I'll drink to that.
You're here.
Before we get to your complexity issue, I want to ask why, I've always wondered this, why 101 proof? So yeah, traditional proof is 80 proof. Then you have the 86 proof, which is called the Kentucky proof. And we'll probably talk about that later when we introduce some bottles. But then you have 90 proof, 100 proof, whatever. So why 101 proof?
So the 101 proof, first off, I think it's important to note, whenever we talk about bourbon, we talk about, you know, one of the stipulations behind is that it cannot come off the still at greater than 160 proof. Okay. With that being said, what that 160 proof and lower does is it captures more of those ester oils, more of that, those fragrances, those taste profiles. So typically what you find in bourbons is they lean between 150 and 160. Okay.
Right.
What I think is very important to note about Wild Turkey 101, which I did not know until probably about a week ago, is that their stuff comes off the still at 109 proof. So for the ones that don't know what that means, it's a very lower proof to come off of a still, which means it is packed full of flavor to begin. Like, we're talking right out the gate, it's full of flavor. So what they did was, whenever they bottled their very first barrel, bottled it, and then whenever they drained it and proofed it, it just organically came out at 101 proof. And so whenever it organically came out at 101, they were like, all right, here it is, it's 101 proof.
So it was basically their first run of it. It came out at 101 proof and they tasted it, thought it was good, stuck with it.
Yeah, it's one of those things. In my life, I don't get that lucky to do a trial and error thing. And it's like, oh, great. Hey, it works for us. Mine's like, all right, 57 more errors to go through. But hey, for them, it worked. And I can tell you that I'm a huge fan.
Awesome. I am too. And I think I've noticed something about myself. After watching the past three episodes, I constantly am drinking through this thing. So you would think that we would take a sip and then put it down, talk, and then sip at the end. But I think I may have a problem. Anyway, so my question is, the first two episodes, we put legacy brands on the bar. So we put Evan Williams Bottled and Bond, we put George Dickel. For the third episode, we went craft. So with two legacy brands already on the bar, why did you feel like we needed another legacy brand on the bar?
Okay, so first off, for me, even though it is a legacy brand, it's one of those big boys, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
The reason that I chose this one in itself is the complexity. I chose it because if anyone has not had it, or for those that have. The complexity in itself just not to take away from anybody else, but the complexity for this specific brand, this specific proof even, you know what I mean? Because, and we'll get into this later, but they've got 81 proof. They've got, dude, they've got probably 25 different brands, you know, and I don't, that's not a, an exact amount, but this one specifically has such a complexity about it. It's the flavors, man. The flavors are so in your face that I think that, let me be for myself real quick. I'm going to dog leg for just a minute. I'm a fat guy, and so I like to eat. And so whenever we talk about like bourbons or we talk about anything like that, I compare things to two things. I like to have my pours of bourbon as I'm either A, eating certain meals, or B, smoking cigars, et cetera. And so with this one here, like you have some of the ones like the one we just did with the Yellowstone, a very lighter whiskey. This is more of a dense, heavier, more mouthfeel type. And so I personally would pair this one up really good with a steak. I think it would go great with a steak. And I think that it would go great with a cigar, a 10-year cigar. And so that's why I think that this one would be one good for the bar, not an everyday drink. If you like to have a pour a day, I'm not sure that this is going to be the one to have the pour every day, but this is definitely a Friday night. It's the end of the week. I'm relaxing. We have a pour, light a cigar, have a steak, whatever. This pairs with all of those.
Okay. I got you. So what makes it complex? Like what's the mash bill on it? Is it like is it a high rye mash bill or something?
You know, oddly enough, which I guess for a bourbon, it could be on the higher rye side. But oddly enough, this is just kind of a generic. It's 75% corn, 13% rye, 12% barley. So really not much different than any other bourbon that we taste. I mean, it's not now the barley and the rye, you know, they can flip and flop. And so those being known as, and I do want to nerd out for just a minute, those are known as your flavoring grains. But I think that those have a lot to do with it, but it's not that high rye that you would taste, because I'm also a very big rye whiskey fan, and it doesn't have that rye whiskey taste, that rye whiskey feel. So I really, to be honest with you, what I think, and I can't back this up with proof, I don't have the facts to go with it, but what I think happens is with this specific mash bill, you know, we've talked before that you can have the same environment, the same, you know, every element that goes into one batch, but the taste is different. Now it may not be much different, but it's going to be different. But what I think that goes into this, I think that what gives it its complexity, again, my personal opinion, is I think that whenever it comes out of the still at 109, whenever I found that out after tasting this, it makes sense. I mean, because sometimes you may taste a bourbon and you kind of get, I'm not going to say a void, but you have this from the front palate to the mid palate to the back palate, you have this I don't know area, right? There's nothing that I don't know about this. From the first time I taste it until I breathe it out, everything is full body. And I think that has to do with such the low proof that it came off.
Okay. That makes sense. All right. So let's change gears a minute and let's talk about where did the name Wild Turkey come from?
There was a guy named Turkey. And he was just wild.
He was a wild guy.
He was a wild guy.
We are two wild and crazy guys.
You raised me pretty much. So there's that. There was, so the ripey or rippy, and if any of your family is listening to this, please understand there is no disrespect. If it does, he did it. It was the Ripey brothers that owned this distillery. Okay. So in 1940, I guess one of their executives, or if they were the executive or whatever, I'm not trying to butcher this, but they went on this hunting trip and was kind of sharing pours and samples of this, the latest product. And from that, it deemed to, I can only imagine it was a turkey hunting trip. So it had to be early spring. And so from there, it deemed it this wild turkey whiskey. And so I'm not an avid hunter, but I can appreciate that.
Yeah.
A little odd story here. Do you know anything about hunting a whole lot?
I know you use a gun and you kill things.
Okay. So, you know, obviously more than I do. No, you know, when I was in Fort Leonard Wood, I talked with a guy that every time he went hunting, and now that I'm retelling this story, he did use wild turkey, and that I don't think that was intentional. I think this is just kind of for what it is. But they say that whenever you have your scopes on a deer or whatever you're hunting, your adrenaline goes. And he says that every time I would go hunting, I would take a shot of wild turkey before I hunted. That way my nerves were calm and I could get an accurate shot on the deer or whatever. And so I wonder if they took this new whiskey and everybody took a shot of it because they wanted to calm their nerves before the hunt. And then that's what named it this wild turkey. That's, you know what? It may not be true, but it's romanticized.
Yeah. Sounds good. Okay. So what other expressions of this do we have?
Man, I'm going to go to my notes here. So if I look like I'm reading, it's because I am.
You're reading.
So you got wild turkey 81, which oddly enough, the 81 proof was, introduced in 2011. 80 proof was introduced in 1974. And so you got wild turkey 81. That's kind of like your flagship. There it is. This is kind of what it is.
Can I interrupt you for 1 second?
Please do.
I was today years old when I realized that wild turkey, the regular, was 81 proof. So I wasn't a big bourbon fan, or I'm not a fan. I wasn't into bourbon like I am now back in 2011. So that's right about the time I was getting into moonshine and that kind of thing. But I never knew that wild turkey was 81 proof. I just thought it was 80 proof like every other flagship, like, you know, starter bourbon was. I had no idea that it was 81 proof. So I was today years old when I found that out.
Well, it used to be 79 proof. And the guy said, and I quote, "This is dumb." And then from there, it became,
let's bump it up 2 proof.
Let's bump it up 2 proof. No. So, you know, another thing that I like about the Wild Turkey brand, I don't know if tenacity would be the word or whatever, but it's like, all right, you're doing 80. We got 81. Buck up. You know what I mean? I think that's cool. So you've got Wild Turkey 81. You've got Wild Turkey Rye 81, which I'm going to say this, probably alluding to, I can only imagine one of our future episodes, but the Wild Turkey Rye, top notch.
Stupid good.
Right there, but man. Okay. Then you got Wild Turkey 101. You've got Wild Turkey Rye 101. You got Rare Breed. So, interesting story. You got Rare Breed 6, 8, and 12. And what Rare Breed is it's a barrel proof blend, okay, of 6, 8, and 12. I was deployed from January to July of this past year. And my wife, Courtney, she calls me, I guess it was probably late June, early July. I'm about 3 weeks out from heading home. She says, "Babe," she said, "I want to buy you a bottle of whiskey. Whenever you get home, a bottle of bourbon, and I don't know what you want. I don't know what you like." And of course you remember this. And I said, "Well, you know, I don't really want to tell you what I want because that ruins the surprise." I said, "Call Bo. he'll tell you. So I get home, I get off the plane, right? I get off the plane, you know, been up for, it seems like 20 weeks. Give her a hug and a kiss, kiss the kids, whatever. Anyway, she drives me home. I get home and she has a bottle of Rare Breed, which I've never had before until then. And so she makes me a pour just to kind of unwind. And, you know, coming back, seeing them for the first time in 6 months, I'm like this. And so I have my pour. And I was like, my gosh, this is absolutely amazing. Quick story for a, you know, a quick expression.
Which is funny because when she asked me what to get you, I said anything between $6 and $9 is about what he likes. So she did not take my advice, by the way.
She paid $8.72. They also have a Kentucky Spirit, which is a single barrel. I don't know a lot about that. They got a Long Branch, which actually I have had this. It is very good. It is actually a Texas mesquite wood. It's kind of got that blend of Texas mesquite wood. They have a Master's Keep, which is 17 years. They've got a Master's Keep Decades. They've got a Master's Keep Revival. Then you get into your Russell Reserve.
Those are so good.
Oh, dude. Russell Reserve, 10-year. Rye, 6-year. Single barrel rye. Then you get your American Honey, and then your American Honey Stink. Just so happened out of pure luck that in 2018, I became allergic to honey. And it's not really the honey that I'm allergic to. It's what the bees eat. So I can't have honey because my ears and my throat get crazy. But American is very good.
Sucks for you.
Yeah, it does. It really does suck for me.
All right. So we talked about all those expressions, but what would, if we're going to put the 101 in our bar, what would people pay for that?
Okay. So I'm a big fan of the Booze app as well. And according to the Booze app, and I will say this, I know that you mentioned this in the first episode, we are not endorsed by Booze app, nor do we get any kind of compensation. However, I've used Booze app for this because whenever I go to pay for something, I always, because I'm not going to pay any more than what's a fair price. I'm just not going to do it. Before I'm a bourbon entrepreneur, I'm a cheapskate. So according to Booze app, average MSRP is around $25, but a fair price of it is $28. I paid $29 for this. What's a dollar, right? And so I think we'll be good there. So I would say that probably average across the bar for this product right here would be about $29. And I'm trying to think because this looks a little bigger than your average fifth, but either way, I paid $29 for it.
Off topic question. In your state in Arkansas, can you buy liquor at a grocery store, like a Kroger or Walmart or whatever?
So Arkansas is weird. It depends on the county. So I live in Lonoke County. Absolutely not. However, I don't think it's Saline. It may be Saline County. In Saline County, there is a Trader Joe's where I can buy Islay scotch.
Yeah.
So in Trader Joe's, I can buy it there, but I can't. So there's only like 3 wet counties here, man. Everywhere else is completely dry. And Saline County being the next county or 2 counties over. Yeah.
The reason I ask is because here in Kentucky, you can buy things at like Kroger or Walmart or whatever. And what I think that does is I think that drives the prices down just a little bit because like I can go to the Kroger right down the street and they may have like last week we talked about Yellowstone and I mean, it's a $40 bourbon and I usually can get it there like $32, $33. And so, you know, with the discounts and stuff. So I think that kind of helps drive prices a little bit, you know, I won't say drive them down, but keep them in check if that makes sense. So,
well, yeah,
that makes sense.
You know, but for me, so being active duty military at the shop at, which is like, you know, the base classics, the liquor store, they're open 7 days a week. So I can buy whiskey there 7 days a week. And for there, the price is about 26 bucks.
Yeah, I got
Again, you. I'm also not paying taxes. Mm-hmm. So, but for the average listener, especially if you're in Arkansas, expect about 29 bucks Monday through Saturday.
That works. That's fine. That's a good, it's still a good price for what you get. I mean, it's 20 proof, 21 proof, higher than, you know, the normal traditional 80 proof bourbon. So if my math is right. All right. So let's get to the good stuff. Okay. What we always kind of ask it like this, what should the average drinker be tasting? But I want to just ask it like this. What do you taste? I don't want to tell people what they should be tasting because I'm not an expert, neither are you, and we're probably wrong, but what are you tasting?
So there's three parts to this. Number one, I am an expert.
Gotcha.
Number two, I taste bubblegum. So, okay, because I'm a nerd, and when my wife and I go on date nights, she laughs at me quite a lot because we go to these places and I'll either order a bourbon or things like that. And I usually end up giving some type of a class anytime that we go. Even, dude, we went out to eat this past weekend. And I'm like, what kind of bourbons do you have? She's like, Jack Daniels. I'm like, ma'am, let me stop you real quick. You know, and I always, in a joking way. But when I take this bourbon and I swirl it, and I smell it, because smelling is how you taste it first. First off, it's got a beautiful color. Smelling it first, and it smells like, it almost smells just like corn. It has a corny taste, and I know that that's very cliche, but that's what I smell. When I taste it, though, on this front palate, I do taste that corn flavor. All right, that's the very first thing you taste is like a buttery corn. And I know that that is cliche, but for those of you that don't know, corn adds a specific mouthfeel. It adds a specific smoothness and it adds a specific sweetness to any bourbon. I'll argue with anybody on that. It just does. From there, I go to the mid palate. Now, remember earlier in the podcast or in the talk here, we talked about some bourbons kind of go from mid palate to back palate and they skip. This one doesn't. This mid palate here is a spice. Not like a pepper or anything like that, but it's just that certain spice that almost preludes and leads into this back palate. The back palate is the spicy rye flavor.
Yeah, I get that.
But the back palate to that spicy rye completely gives way to me vanilla, caramel, and dude, if we're being honest, I taste toffee in that back, which I'm a toffee fan. But that's that on that back palate, that spicy rye, it's a spicy that gives way to that vanilla, caramel, toffee blend, I guess.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, so you're 100% sure we should put this on the bar?
I am 100% sure.
Are you 101% sure?
I'm 101% sure this goes on the bar. If not, I'll shoot your turkey.
Idiot. Well, here's cheers to that.
I'll drink to that.
All right, man. Until next week, I love you.
Love you.
But you're stupid.
You said you love me and my mother, but I'm stupid.
I love you and your mother, and you're my brother, and you're stupid.
Agreed, all accounts.
All right, man. I'll see you next week. I love you, man.
Love you.
Bye.
Bye.
If you like what you heard, check us out on these social media platforms. Just search for My Journey Through the American Spirits.